Welcome. So you guys are 11 years in to the business.
Yeah.
10 markets. Does it ever feel surreal that you've seen how far Love Bonito has gone since its early days as a blog shop?
Yeah. You know, when we first started, it was really like a passion project. A couple of my friends and I came together because we really wanted to sell pre-loved clothes for extra pocket money.
Mm.
And of course, over the years, you know, we saw a need to cater to the Asian women. So that's why in my final year of university, with no fashion, no business, no design background, decided to drop out of school to co-start Love Bonito, to really create for women like ourselves, for other real women. And I think that has been such an amazing journey over the last decade.
So looking back at all the years that since you started Love Bonito, right?
Mm.
Was there a particularly difficult or challenging moment in your career?
I remember it was around 2013. I was feeling really exhausted, jaded, and I was really wondering what Love Bonito's true purpose and calling is.
Mm.
I remember a customer wrote in to me on email. It was really random. Back then, it seemed really random. But then she wrote in to me and she said, "Hey Rach, I would like to come down to share with you a little bit about how Love Bonito has made a difference in my life."
Mm.
So I remember it was 30th August 2013. She came down to my office. Back then, we were still at Kallang Pudding. And when she walked into my office, she was this mid-20s young woman. She was walking and talking very slowly, especially from the right side of her body, because her entire left side was not really mobile. So I sat her down and she told me, you know, through the last 6 months, I've been in and out of major surgeries, brain surgeries, because there was something sitting on the left nerve of her brain. During the days where she had to pick herself up to face the world, to go back to, you know, medical checkups, to go back to job interviews, she said, "Every day I choose to put on a piece of Love Bonito clothing because it makes me feel a little bit more confident about myself. It makes me feel a little bit prettier and gives me the courage to look in the mirror." And to hear it from someone like that, you know, the impact that the brand has been able to have on her was really mind-blowing.
Yeah.
I believe at the end of the day that Love Bonito is in the business of women.
Mm.
And fashion is just, you know, one conduit for us.
So knowing what you know now as an entrepreneur and as a leader, what would you think you would change when you first started out?
Wow.
Or would you change anything at all?
Mm. I think this has been such a journey with so many heartaches, mistakes, lessons, tears, you know. Yeah, but if there's one thing I wish I'd known earlier, I wish I had taken the time to, you know, start being in tune with myself a lot earlier to really understand and know who I am, who I'm not, what drives me, what drains me, what are my natural strengths and weaknesses. Back then when I started, the people that I would look up to are like Steve Jobs, Mark Zuckerberg. And I tried to emulate, you know, whatever I would read about them, their traits, their behavior, their attitudes. And I would really hate myself for it, you know. When I go back at the end of the day, I would realize, oh my God, this is not me at all. I honestly was, you know, thinking to myself, okay, does this mean that I'm not meant to be a leader? Because society has a way of telling us what leaders are meant to be.
Traditionally, it should be
business. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. And one of my team members, it was a very innocent comment, but it hit me so hard. She said, "Hey, but Rach, what you have is not what we have." And it's something that sounds so simple, but I think that was what I really needed then. And then that struck me, you know, and I thought to myself, oh my God, you're right. You know, for me, the definition of success at the end of the day is this quote by this American philosopher. He said, "To be yourself in a world that's constantly trying to make you something else is the greatest accomplishment."
So you have a little boy.
He just turned one a few days
ago. Who just turned one.
Yeah.
And they say that there are many similarities between parenting and running a business.
Mm.
Do you agree? What kind of similarities?
Yes, I do. In fact, yeah, I really do agree. And it's something I do think about here and there.
Yeah.
Firstly, right, I think the role of a parent or a leader in an organization, you have so much responsibility over their lives.
Yeah.
In a sense, the decisions that you make almost directly impacts them. And, you know, one thing that my mom has taught me through her own parenthood journey is always, you know, I've always asked her, hey mom, what makes you a great parent? I think my mom is a great mom. And she said, well, raising a kid is really like learning how to fly a kite. You must know when to release the tension. Mm. You must know when to pull back. One of my mentors told me that, you know, our responsibilities that we juggle are balls, right?
Mm.
And they are either made up of glass balls or rubber balls. And she said, you need to know in the different seasons, which ones are your glass balls that you absolutely cannot afford to drop. Because if you drop them, they would shatter. And which ones you need to know are rubber balls, where you can temporarily drop them and you know that they will bounce back up. They wouldn't break, they wouldn't shatter.
Okay.
But you can afford to let them go in that season. Because there is only so many hours in the day, so much energy you can have in the day, so much that you can give within a certain amount of time.
Yeah, so what do you need to prioritize?
What do you need to prioritize and what needs to give? Because I think at the end of the day, what's most important is you need to be well, you need to be filled, right? You can't give from an empty tank. A lot of things are unpredictable and not within your control. So I just ensure that I am as productive as possible, being fully present in whatever time that I carve out to spend with my team or even with Ollie, so that I don't find myself distracted when I'm with Ollie. I'm worrying about a certain email, or when I'm attending to my team, I'm worrying about Ollie. So I try to be as present as possible.
So thanks so much for dropping me off and for doing this interview.
Thank you, Xiaowei. I enjoyed myself.
Yeah, I had a good time as well.
Yeah, you have a good rest of the day.
You too. I see you soon.